Chapter 1 of the Mind the Paint Girl. The Mind the Paint Girl by Louis Tracy. Chapter 1. A May Morning. The music of the band came nearer. The cold streams were marching from Chelsea to relieve the grenadiers. Strollers in the park, loungers in Pall Mall and St. James's Street seemed to quicken visibly under the lilt and rhythm of the lively air. A crowd, mostly drawn from the provinces and overseas, had gathered already on the pavement, either beneath the wall of Marlborough House or on the south of Palace Square, and even the case-hardened cockneys, who happened to be passing, hurried to watch the daily pageant of guard mounting. The oncoming band acted on them as a magnet acts on steel filings. As it approached, each human atom became active. Two men, neither of whom had seen the other, turned out of Pall Mall about the same moment, but on opposite sides of Marlborough Gate. The elder of the pair, unmistakably the type of retired soldier, which ranges from colonel to field marshal, had just quitted a club in St. James's Street. If hair and moustache were white, his figure was trim and erect, and at the martial strains of the band his shoulders unconsciously squared themselves, and his face lost an expression of settled melancholy, singularly out of keeping with spruce attire and military bearing. The younger man, tall and strongly built, was a captain in a line battalion, but walked with the air and swing of a cavalryman. He came from Pall Mall, and a casual glance at the sentry in front of Marlborough House, in order to learn, from the colour of the cockade and the arrangement of buttons on the scarlet tunic, what regiment had been on duty during the previous 24 hours, cost him an opportunity of recognising an old friend. London gives or withholds such haphazard encounters with callous indifference. In ordinary conditions, these two might not have met a second time within the year, but now the band, with blood-stirring clash of brass and cymbals, had wheeled out of the park into the Walpent Road, and alert policemen were shepherding the onlookers into compact masses. Again the band wheeled, some staccato orders made themselves heard above the din of drums and instruments. The old guard's rifles clattered to the present. The new guard became two solid lines of black and red, faced to the left, and moved in toward the square. Then the crowd broke, eager to gain a few yards closer view of the spectacle, and this reshuffling of its units brought the two army men side by side.
"Hello, Nico!"
"Hello, Colonel!"
Their hands met with a ready clasp of friendship.
"My wife tells me you are in town. She saw you last night in the stalls at the Pandora, so we were expecting you to call," said the veteran.
"Yes, of course, this afternoon, without fail," said Nico Jays. Nico to his intimates, but Captain Nicholas Jays of the North Devons to the wider world.
"The CO gave me 10 days district leave, and I reached town from the Curragh yesterday, just in time to dress and eat before going to the theatre."
Colonel, the Honourable Arthur Stidoff, for all that he was a society man to the tips of his well-manicured fingers, had an incurable trick of allowing his face to betray his thoughts. A slight frown of bewilderment now chased away the smile which had welcomed Jays.
10 days in May!" he exclaimed. "I had a notion you were keen on soldiering, Nico."
"So I am, sir. Nobody more so. Yet even Napoleon kicked when he was sent from Paris to Auxon, and the Curragh is a deuce of a hole after Aldershot."
Stidoff snorted disapproval.
"Put your profession first, my boy, and a jolly long first before the Pandora Theatre and its frills," he said. "You'll hardly believe it, knowing me as you do, but time was when I would have jumped down my junior captain's throat if he had asked for 10 days' leave in the very height of the drill season. Sorry, Nico."
For the tired old eyes had detected a flush of embarrassment beneath the tan of his hearer's cheeks.
"That's a beastly inhospitable remark, and you know I don't mean it in that sense. Just for a moment I put myself in loco parentis. Perhaps Satan rebuking sin would be a better simile, because your father died in harness, whereas I, well, here I am, tiptoeing among the mob to gaze at my own regiment. Dash it all! It's a fine morning. Let's talk of something else.
Jays had his own reasons for falling in readily with the suggested change of topic.
"Most of the men here are new to me," he said. "Who is the grenadier subaltern with the colours?" "Oh, that's Farncombe, nice boy, son of the Earl of Godalming."
"Viscount Farncombe?"
"Yes."
"Lucky chap. Soldiering is made easy for him."
"So it was for me, yet I had to chuck the service soon after I got command of the battalion."
Then Jays could have bitten his tongue viciously, if that could have withdrawn the unhappy remark, for it was an open secret that Stidoff had been refused an extension, sure preliminary to a district and a major generalship, because he had married Dolly Ensor, a minor star of the Pandora galaxy. The Honourable Mrs. Arthur Stidoff might have averted the deadly effect of the mésalliance had she been sufficiently plastic to adapt herself to the ways and usages of society, but she was a good deal more of a Pandora girl after marriage than before. She regarded her rise in the social scale as justifying a loudness of manner which the stage manager had sternly repressed on the boards of the theatre, and, as the direct outcome, her husband was shelved professionally. Not that Mrs. Stidoff cared a jot. Married to the brother of an earl, and fairly well provided with money, so long as she remained within the four walls of the law, she could not be ousted wholly from the sacred enclosures of the upper 10,000. Fully content, she tripped joyously through life, and the ex-colonel of the guards gained as Dolly Ensor's husband, a celebrity denied to his military career. In his confusion, the younger man could find nothing to say. As for Stidoff, he was gazing hungrily at the little group of officers who had now broken up into pairs and were strolling to and fro while sergeants and corporals marched reliefs to the various posts in the precincts of the palaces. The band had become an orchestra, and the conductor, after submitting a programme to the senior captain, raised his baton. When Jays heard the opening bars of a selection, his face brightened.
"By Jove, Colonel," he said, "these fellows are bang up to date. They're playing the Duchess of Brixton, and it was only produced a week ago."
The older man came back from his daydream.
"Yes," he said, "I was there. Mrs. Stidoff is an inveterate first-nighter. Rather a pretty opera, but while I don't pose as an expert in such things, it struck me as lacking the one song or the outstanding bit of acting which usually supplies the clue to a musical comedy."
"Oh, I thought it was capital," protested Jaynes.
His companion laughed mirthlessly.
"You would," he said. "You are young enough to watch the twirling feet of the pretty girls rather than pay heed to such trifles as plot and melody."
"The rotten thing about the stage," commented Jays earnestly, "is the way genuine talent is burked. I can't say how it is with the men, but where the girls are concerned, an actress depends far more on having a pull with the manager, or with some city magnate who is financing the show, than on real ability in her work."
"I have heard that said a great many times, Nico, yet what little experience I have goes to prove the exact contrary. The managerial or financial pull you speak of will never succeed in filling the house. Grit and genius tell on the stage exactly as they command the prizes in every other profession. Why, I could give you a list of names that would surprise you, and in every instance a woman has forced herself to the front by strenuous effort, backed up, of course, by a good voice and good looks. Look at, is he governor?"
broke in a small man with ginger hair and a bristling moustache, who had been striving vainly to catch the strains of the new opera.
"If you wouldn't mind."
Then Colonel Stidoff laughed quite cheerfully.
"I apologise, my friend," he said. "Doing anything, Nico? Come to my club. We'll have a jaw and an early lunch."
"Sorry, I have an appointment farther west,"
Jays consulted his watch.
"I must take a cab," he added. "I had plenty of time to stroll there when I started, but I did not realise how the minutes were slipping along."
"And the years. Don't forget the years. See you at tea."
"Yes, sir. Meanwhile, my best wishes to Mrs. Studolph."
They parted. Carrots nudged his neighbour.
"Blimey," he gurgled. "I didn't catch his name the first time. An honourable he is. Dolly Ance's husband. Fancy me chipping the old cock like that. But he ain't so dead stuck on the stage, is he, Charlie?"
"Knows a damn sight too much about it," said Charlie, who was by way of being a philosopher.
Jays was using no polite fiction when he spoke of taking a cab. He seized the first that presented itself, a hansom, as it happened, the taximeter being just at the beginning of its triumphal descent on London, and told the driver to rush him to Hyde Park Corner. The hands of the clock over the lodgekeeper's house stood exactly at 11 as he sprang to the pavement, and he hurried across the row with an air of urgency, fully explained by the cheerful impatience with which he was greeted by a pretty girl awaiting him near the statue of Achilles.
"Caught you tripping at last! You are late, Nico," she cried.
"Only 1 minute,"
he protested, his somewhat heavy face brightening with joy at sight of her.
"I'm at Colonel Studolph, and I couldn't in decency hurry away, especially as he was lecturing me."
"What about? About me?"
"No, Lily, thank God. He has never even heard your name."
"But, Nico, why so serious? Why should you offer up thanks because I am a Miss Nobody of nowhere, whom no one ever even heard of, as you say?"
Evidently the two were bent on some more definite object than a mere stroll in the park, for they had turned in the direction of Stanhope Gate without any discussion as to the route they should follow. The girl, tall, slim, and quietly attired, moved with an easy, supple elegance. She was young, not yet 20, and youth is naturally graceful, but the expert eye would determine at a glance that she was a dancer, and in all probability an uncommonly good one. A blue serge costume, neat gloves and boots, and a hat by no means flamboyant in style or size, showed that Miss Lily Paradell, though only a coryphée in the Pandora Theatre, did not share the average taste of her class for bizarre garments. Despite her youth, she had graduated in the hard academy of pantomime and music hall, and her companion's fervour with regard to her professional insignificance was hardly justified, since it was no small achievement that she should have won her way already through the most closely guarded stage door in London. The rounded brows over the big, earnest eyes she had raised to her escort's face showed that she was surprised, perhaps a trifle resentful of his tone, and a slight wave of colour heightened and glorified her somewhat pale cheeks. Always pretty, Lily Paradell had suddenly become beautiful, and had Captain Jays been more finely observant, he might have made the delightful discovery that a bright intelligence was her greatest charm, but he could only feel that he had somehow struck a false note, and he hastened to correct the blunder.
"I didn't mean that, Lily, and you are merely teasing me by pretending that you think otherwise," he said. "In fact, poor old Stidolf's remarks ran in a precisely contrary sense. I was grumbling about the difficulty a really smart girl encounters in making a start, in raising herself above the common level, that is, but he stuck out that the stage does really offer la carrière ouverte au talent."
"How are you getting on with your French?"
"Well, enough to understand that," she said gleefully. "And your friend is right, Nico. Not that he, let me see, didn't he marry Dolly Ensor?"
"Yes."
"Why do you say yes in that way?"
"Because the Honourable Arthur used to be such a smart chap in my time at Sandhurst, and now he's a back number."
"He should have done more with his life than simply marry a woman who happened to be a bit of a celebrity, why didn't he make a career for himself? Happily, Jays had tact enough to check the imminent explanation.
He rather lost touch with soldiering, I fancy, he said.
But the girl's sharp ears had caught the pause, the careful weighing of the reply before it was uttered. Was it because he married an actress? She demanded, quickly.
Good gracious, no. There's no bar to social progress nowadays.
Some mischievous thought danced in the girl's eyes, which continued to search her friend's sunburned face inquisitively. Lots of our high kickers marry lords, which is a cut above an honourable, I suppose. She seemed to be musing aloud, but there was no uncertainty in the succeeding question, which was very much to the point. Nico, what would you say if I made a hit, and all the giddy young gadders about town began chasing me?
May I smoke? Said Chase.
Yes, but answer me.
I would be pleased, of course, and frantically jealous, equally, of course. Now, let's chuck problems and admire the flowers. We cross here. The beds begin at the other side of Stanhope Gate.
Nico, I'm serious. As to the hit, at any rate, I have been given my chance.
What do you mean? Has that silly little ass, Lionel Roper, been filling your head with nonsense?
The stalwart captain's voice had grown harsh. He knew that this charming girl was flirting with him, innocently, leading him on, and he hated himself for the miserable truckling to convention which held him back from the supreme step of asking her to be his wife. "Please don't call Uncle Lal rude names," said Lily, though the tremendous news which she could no longer retain choked down the resentment she would certainly have expressed at any other time. The ill-tempered reference to Roper was quite unwarranted, since he had proved to be a real friend to herself and her mother. "I'm thoroughly in earnest. Maury Cooling, our business manager, you know, was growling the other night about the lack of go in the Duchess of Brixton, and Vincent Bland, the composer, he really is a duck. All the girls love him. Remembered that I sang a little ballad rather well one night in the Canterbury, and, what do you think? He has written me a song, full stage, with chorus. I'm rehearsing it today for the first time, and I really do believe it will catch on." The concluding words rose in a crescendo of excitement, and, for once, she was blind to the scowl on her companion's face. Matters had come to that pitch. He was furiously resentful of any influence that might lift Lily Paradell into prominence, lest his own dog-in-the-manger policy should be endangered. But he had the sense and good breeding to conceal his feelings for the hour.
"By Jove! I congratulate you, Lil," he managed to stammer. "Is it a decent sort of song? What's the air like?"
"Oh, it goes with a splendid swing, and it has such a jolly catchword. I'm supposed to be the mind the paint girl. This is the chorus of the first verse. Mind the paint, no matter whether Maple's bills are settled or they ain't. Once you smear it, or you scratch it, it's impossible to match it. So take care, please, of the paint, of the paint. Isn't it great? Can't you hear it on the barrel organs? If only I work it up, as I think I can, it will go through town like the flu." Jays pulled her out of the way of a noiseless electric brougham. In her enthusiasm, Lily had forgotten her surroundings. Though she was only humming a refrain, her artist's eyes were gazing at a dim and crowded house beyond the footlights. She heard the subdued strains of the orchestra. She watched the conductor's uplifted baton. This was her opportunity, and she must seize it with both hands, now. The motor stole past with silent speed. It had crept too near, and might have knocked her down, but for Jay's prompt help. Yet Lily Paradell was still seeing visions, and being a vivacious young lady, she laughed at the careless chauffeur. "Mind the paint!" she cried, and a bewhiskered face, crowned by a silk hat, was framed for an instant in the brougham's window. "Oh dear!" she sighed. "Now I've gone and done it. That was Carlton Smythe.
Whatever will he think of me? To her, the manager of the Pandora Theatre was a tremendous deity, throned high on some peak of the Thespian Olympus. In reality, he was a shrewd and cautious judge of public taste in musical comedy, and he was thinking that if the girl would only throw as much animation into the new song on stage as she had displayed in the park, the Duchess of Brixton was safe for 100 nights at least.
"See what it is to have a steady-going chap like me handy," said Jays. "If I hadn't been just in the right place, you would have been run over."
"Nor would I have been singing and generally playing the giddy goat in Hyde Park. Still, I'm awfully obliged to you, Nico, dear. You know you come first all the time, no matter what the future may have in store." She flashed a look at him, and such a wealth of tender kindliness poured from her deep blue eyes that his brain reeled. He could not guess, Lily herself could not have told him, that friendship rather than love inspired that thrilling glance. Youth, abounding vitality, the first glimpse of beckoning ambition, such was the formula of the magic elixir coursing through her veins on that bright May morning. It rendered her more than ever desirable. Given her favour, no man could resist her. And Nicholas Jays was a man, though neither bright nor swift of nature. Least of all did he understand women, or he would have known that Lily Paradell was simply brimming over with high spirits and good nature. When she loved, she would die rather than offer her love. Yet it was a moment fraught with possibilities. A breathed word, a caressing pressure of the girl's arm, and the divine spark might have reached the hidden store of passion in Lily's heart. Jay's gloved hands were clenched fiercely. He was on the verge of what he regarded as a social precipice, when an aristocratic dame, leading a Pekingese dog, met the two as they reached the path and gave him a gracious nod of recognition.
"Who was that?"
said Lily in an undertone.
"Lady Valetort,"
muttered Jays. "Friend of yours?"
"Yes, friend of my mother's, to be exact."
"She didn't forget to look me up and down. You know heaps of people like her, I suppose. Ought you to be walking with me here, Nico?"
"Don't talk nonsense. Why shouldn't I walk with you here or anywhere else?"
"You might have said it was an honour conferred by me, dear boy, but you didn't, and you're right. I'm not in your set."
"That word set is the most detestable word in the English language."
"There are others, and we wouldn't use them if they had no meaning. But we're not going to quarrel, Nico, because Lady What's-Her-Name raised her eyebrows. Here are the flowers. How perfectly beautiful. Now I can see what you meant when you said last evening that we Londoners would call the gods to witness that there was nothing in the world to equal them if we saw such a display in Paris. Yet we passed them by unnoticed in dear old foggy London. But who christened them such awful names? Ah, here is something in my line. Don't touch. Keep off the grass. Don't you see? It's another way of telling you to mind the paint. You'll be in town next Monday? Yes, how jolly! I shall feel more at home if I see you in the stalls, grinning like a Cheshire cat, and yelling for an encore. Some girls pack the theatre on the first night of a new song just to make it go. But I shan't. I couldn't, if I wanted to ever so. There's only you and Lal Roper and Bertie Fulkerson, if he hasn't dined too well."
"Pooh! Bertie Fulkerson, young idiot!"
Captain Nicholas Jays was himself again, and the North Devon's mess at the Curragh was spared a sensation. But Cupid, perhaps, stole away among the flowers and sulked until some other youthful pair aroused his interest or sought his sympathy. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of the Mind the Paint Girl. The Mind the Paint Girl by Louis Tracy. Chapter 2. The New Star. Although Jays was not rich, he was not poor. He had a fair private income in addition to his pay. He was well connected,
the envied possessor of uncles and elderly relatives highly placed in the services, in the War Office, and in other government departments. In a word, with that steady attention to work which our British variety of nepotism insists upon, he was certain to find the way of promotion made easy. Nor was there any valid reason why he should not marry. With due economy, he and his wife could not only follow the beaten track of regimental life, but meander into some of its luxurious byways. They would have no difficulty about houses, furniture, a dog-cart, the maintenance of a couple of polo ponies, or the purchase of a smart frock for Mrs. Jay's when the GOC's garden party came round. To say the least of it, such conditions warranted a young man in spending a joyous week in London during the height of the season, and yet Jay's would have been far happier had fate compelled him to endure the blistering ennui of some sand-encircled cantonment in the Punjab. There he would perforce attend early morning parade, read and smoke or sleep after luncheon, curse the climate at decent intervals, whack a polo ball over an iron-bound maiden, play bridge or billiards at the club, and dine with 20 hard-bitten Britons like himself. Lily Paradell would have been 6,000 miles away, and it was not in his nature to sigh after the impossible. But in London, her enchanting, distracting personality yielded odd half-hours of delight and filled the remainder of existence with a species of sullen despair. Not every morning, because rehearsals were exigent, but as often as she could spare her time, he met her by appointment. Weather permitting, they went to one or other of the parks. She would visit the zoo every day if he would take her, because she loved animals and had a way with her that conquered the doubting shyness of the creatures of the wild, or, if walking meant a trudge through mud and rain, they would drive to the National Gallery, South Kensington, the British Museum, the Wallace Collection. Jay's hailed a dismal sky almost with delight, merely because of the educational value of those quiet strolls through galleries and exhibitions. He assured himself that some day he would defy convention and marry Lily Paradell, and he took a keen joy in the task of communicating to her now such scanty knowledge of the arts as he possessed. She was a willing listener, never bored or weary. She had a marvellous memory, forgot no hint of the right way to pronounce foreign and classical names, asked for reasons, and applied them correctly when tested over new ground. With it all, there was the pleasing consciousness that Lily looked up to him as a paragon of erudition. To justify her faith in him, he bought booklets on Turner, on Correggio, on the Elgin marbles, on the china of Bow and Chelsea and Meissen, and studied them privily in his bedroom at the club. Then, helped by a quick glance at a catalogue, he would hold forth as to the atmospheric depth of Ulysses deriding Polyphemus, or the exquisite glaze and colouring of a Dresden shepherdess, anno 1760. In truth, he was teaching himself some of these things, and more than once the girl's innate taste, helped by an alert brain which remembered everything, caught him tripping. Nevertheless, his manners and speech were different from Lily's, which still kept a touch of her humble beginnings, and every night, after the sweet intimacy of the homeward drive to Mrs. Upjohn's apartments, the Lily Paradell of the Pandora Theatre was Lily Upjohn in the Kennington Park Road, where she and her mother shared a bedroom and sitting-room en suite, which, in this instance, meant folding doors. He would leave the girl's humble abode with the shivering foreboding of the day when it would be necessary that his mother should call there. Mrs. Jay's, poor lady, little dreamed of the impending cataclysm. Daughter of a baronet and widow of a distinguished general, she was a good and charitable woman, beloved by all who knew her, but intensely proud of her birth and breeding. What would she say when she heard one of her sons marrying a Pandora girl? And what would she think when she met Mrs. Upjohn, a typical Cockney, without an H in her vocabulary, save in instances where it was superfluous? Indeed, would the two ever meet? Would not the shocked and anguished gentlewoman emphatically refuse to stain her skirts with the dust of Kennington Park Road?
It was no light problem that tortured the big, red-faced, well-groomed captain of North Devon's, and there is little wonder that he shirked its solution. So he drifted helplessly through those scattered hours of happiness and those long-drawn watches of the day and night when care sat heavily on his shoulders, and thus lent himself to the greater folly of letting "I dare not" wait upon "I would." At last came the Monday when Lily Paradell would be made or marred in her profession. It was a big thing for a girl still in her teens to be given a star turn in the leading theatre of London devoted to musical comedy. If she succeeded, she would leap at a bound to the front rank. If, by some mischance, her song did not catch the public fancy, or if nervousness or excitement robbed her for the moment of her witchery of voice and manner, years might pass before another such splendid opportunity presented itself. In the one event, the number would simply be dropped because Carlton Smythe was noted for a Napoleonic quickness of decision. In the other, were there not a score of girls in the chorus, capable of singing it well, and feverishly eager to prove their fitness? Jays had seen little of Lily during the past 3 days. Every spare minute on Friday and Saturday had been devoted to rehearsal. As for Sunday, Vincent Bland, the composer, to whose initiative her selection for the new part was wholly due, insisted that she should remain in bed all day. Lily, of course, rebelled, but Bland belied his name by firm threats of the direst consequences if she disobeyed his orders. On the Monday, however, Jays broke the custom which permitted Lily to reach the theatre unaccompanied, and convoyed her thither in a cab. As they crossed Waterloo Bridge and the magnificent panorama of London, from St. Paul's to the Houses of Parliament spread its glories before their eyes, the girl turned impulsively to the man she regarded, in a curiously impersonal way, as her lover.
"Nico," she said, "are you bringing anyone to the theatre tonight?"
"Bringing anyone?" he repeated.
"Yes. Have you taken only one stall?"
"I'm not exactly what you might call tiny, but I couldn't slop over into two," he replied, veiling a vague uneasiness with clumsy humour.
"But you have a brother and a mother," she persisted. "Why haven't you invited one or both to come with you? I know you would find it difficult to introduce me to your people. Oh, let me say what I want to say. Surely you and I can speak the truth to each other sometimes. But tonight you might have told them that I was a friend, that you were interested in my success."
He was so dumbfounded that he blurted out a more convincing answer than he could have contrived by using his wits.
"Honestly, Lil, I never thought of it," he vowed. "My mind has been running on you these last few days, to the exclusion of everything else. It would have been quite an undertaking, too. My mother lives in Huntingdon, and Bob is up to his eyes on business. He and some other fellows are taking on a big tract of land in Rhodesia, and they have heaps to do before they sail."
For a little while there was silence. No heavy vehicles were near, and the jingle of bells on a group of hansoms or scampering toward the Strand seemed to chime with the golden reverie of a summer evening.
"I suppose your ma doesn't even know you're in town," said Lily suddenly.
Jays loathed that word "ma," and hoped he had cured her of using it. If he had been better versed in the wayward heart of woman, he would have understood that the lapse was intentional, a verbal thrust at all snobbishness and class prejudice.
"No," he said gruffly, "I did not tell my mother I had obtained short leave, because she would have expected me to give her at least one night at home, and I wanted every possible minute for you. Sons are mean in that way, but, at any rate, I try not to hurt her feelings."
The girl's eyes were shining like sapphires. Seeing nothing, they were gazing fixedly at some early diners in the Savoy restaurant. But her emotions bubbled forth without restraint.
"Dear Nico, is he grumpy, then? And isn't Lily Paradell a horrid little wretch? It's nerves, Nico, just nerves. I'm sitting here at your side, demure as a church mouse, to all appearances, but I'm really singing and dancing, flinging myself madly around the stage, a la Lottie Curran's in Tararaboom-dee. Yes, I know it's stupid, and maybe positively harmful, but I can't help it. It's in my blood. Even you men get it occasionally, don't you, when you gamble away a year's income on a game of cards, or join in a rush for some new goldfield. And I am gambling tonight. This is my toss of the dice. It's make or break with me at 9:15.
Now there were 100 ways in which a half-hysterical girl might be soothed by a man who loved her, but Captain Nicholas Jays did not adopt any of them.
"You're frightened. That's what's the matter with you," he laughed. "Only a case of blue funk. Every fellow gets it the first time he goes into action, but it vanishes when the bullets begin to sail past harmlessly. But it vanishes when the bullets begin to sail past harmlessly.
But if having the stage to yourself means going into action, I got over that difficulty before I was 14, she said.
Then she turned and looked at him, marking his stolid aspect.
You're a bit of a humbug yourself, Nico, she tittered. You have taught me heaps about pictures and statues and old furniture, but you really haven't got a glimmer of art in your soul. You're just a stiff, matter-of-fact soldier man, and that's the best and the worst I can say of you.
He was stirred to defend himself.
You might add that I'm also your very loyal friend and well-wisher, he declared.
Perhaps the girl was vouchsafed some glimpse of the mortal struggle raging within, which, in its way, gave a pathetic force to his colourless words, for she placed a hand impulsively on his arm.
I'm more certain of that, Nico, than of carrying the house with me tonight, she said, and there was a tender note in her voice which made divinest music in his ears. But here we are at the theatre. You'll wait for me, of course. A smart hansom, if I knock 'em. Otherwise, a four-wheeler with a broken-winded Gigi.
Goodbye, and good luck.
She smiled dazzlingly from the stage door and was gone. He drove to his club, changed his clothes, ate a hearty meal, and was in his stall at the Pandora before the curtain rose. He was familiar with all the songs and most of the lines of The Duchess of Brixton, and soon discovered that the author and composer had given Lily every reasonable chance of finding her feet before her own special item was reached. She had been promoted from the chorus to a definite character, and had something to say now and then. It was noticeable that her speaking voice filled the theatre, and Jay's, slight as was his knowledge of stagecraft, gasped the essential fact that the hard-won experience of the music hall was enabling her to make her personality felt without effort. A printed slip attached to the programme announced that during the first act, Miss Lily Paradell would sing a new song entitled Mind the Paint, and the presence of a number of critics showed that the management was booming the change. As it happened, Jays had not inquired as to the particular incident in the story which led up to Lily's effort, and the introductory symphony was so brief that he was almost surprised when she bounded forward from the back of the stage and began to sing. She had not uttered a complete line before he knew that she was easily first in a cast which included some of the most notable musical comedy actresses in London. Her fresh, pure voice had in it a joyous lilt which appealed to the audience from the opening note, and her light-hearted audacity gave point and significance to some commonplace lyrics. When she danced to the music of the chorus, that same rhythmic refrain which she had hummed in Hyde Park, it was as though some woodland nymph were rapturously displaying her delight in life, the ecstasy of youth, the half-shy yet all-conquering sense of maiden sovereignty. Instantly the house was on the qui vive for the rising of a new star in the theatrical firmament. The hush of expectation was succeeded by a low murmur of gratified discovery. A subtle sense of unanimity in approval spread throughout the crowded audience, and the thunderous applause that broke forth at the conclusion of the last verse was stilled while the lithe, graceful form was dancing, only to crash out in long-sustained volume as Lily bowed herself breathlessly to the wings, darting one last vivid look at the place where she knew Jays was seated. The tumult could not be quieted until the conductor's baton tapped sharply on the music stand, and the orchestra played the symphony once more. Lily reappeared, smiling and self-possessed. She sang an encore without any sign of exhaustion, and when the chorus was reached, the gallery joined in. "Mind the paint! Mind the paint! A girl is not a sinner just because she's not a saint. But my heart shall hold you dearer. You may come a little nearer if you'll only mind the paint, mind the paint." The glance with which Lily rewarded her unknown friends among the gods was one of the many unrehearsed triumphs of the evening. When she danced again, she had the intoxicating ichor of success in her veins. This time there was no restraint, no subconscious memory of stage directions and the studious posturings of her ballet master. She threw her very soul into motion. Her dancing was the physical expression of an ecstatic spirit. And the house wanted more. Londoners, despite the opinion of their American cousins, are quick as any people in the world to recognise real talent, especially in the theatre, and this acutely critical audience realised that they were privileged to witness an event which would be the talk of the town next day. But Lily neither sang nor danced again that evening. Carlton Smythe, hidden in the corner of a box, had signalled a decision negative to the stage manager. For one thing, he did not wish to subject a valuable recruit to undue strain. For another, he was fully content with the sensational effort already secured. So the girl curtsied and laughed delightedly and wafted kisses from her fingertips to the gallery, and when the orchestra increased the tension by replaying the chorus, the recipients of those kisses testified their appreciation thereby by howling lustily. "Mind the paint! Mind the paint! A girl is not a sinner just because she's not a saint." Such moments are rare, even in the lives of the gifted. They are precious even to genius.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.